Welcome to the viewers for the lecture in the subject structural analysis. Now in this lecture we will take up analysis of pin jointed trusses when it is subjected to moving loads. So before starting, actually we have already completed influence lines. What is an influence line? How to draw influence line for beams? How to draw influence line for bending moment? ILD for shear force? And then application. There are different types of loads. Single concentrated load, two point loads at a fixed distance apart, UDL shorter than the span, UDL longer than the span, and so on. After getting the influence lines, how to use the influence line for getting the bending moment and the shear force in the case of beams, that already we have discussed in lecture number 41, 42 up to 49 we have discussed. Lecture number 50, 51, 52 are in pending. So many viewers are asking for a long time the lecture on this topic, namely ILD for pin jointed trusses. Not only this, there are many other topics. People kindly ask lecture from various sources and on various topics, including Carney's method. Carney's method, I have assured that at the end of November I will give, at the end of October I will give a lecture, but I could not satisfy the requirements because so many topics are going parallelly. Therefore, the viewers need not mistake me. Everything I have in mind, but there is a time. So anyway, with this I will take up the topic. So we will take up the influence line for pin jointed trusses. Now in the case of bridges, normally trusses come in pairs, one on right hand side, one on the left hand side of the bridge. So we know the trusses are subjected to moving loads. Here in the case of bridges, they will be subjected to moving loads. When it is subjected to moving loads, the members, suppose if they are the members of a simply supported truss like this, the top chord members will be under compression, all bottom chord members will be under tension, whereas the inclined members or vertical members, particularly inclined members, will be subjected to either compression or tension. There will be a fluctuation, there will be a change. Number one, the members will be subjected to fluctuating stresses, and also the nature of force in the member itself. An inclined member, PQ or L1, U2, like that. For a particular position of the load, if it acts as a compression member, for some other position of the same load, the same member will be acting as a tension member. So there will be fluctuation of stresses, as well as nature of force itself will vary depending upon the position of the load. So we know that members will be subjected to either axial tension or axial compression. Now this is a bridge. Now this bridge, this is the load moving from and traversing through the bridge. Now this is the truss on the left hand side, this is the truss on the right hand side. Now here the deck slab will receive the load, whatever may be the point load. Suppose this is the deck slab in plan, the load may be somewhere here. It is a moving load, it can occupy any position, right? Now the load will be transferred on the deck slab. Now the deck slab will be having stringer beams in the longitudinal direction below the deck slab. That is, here if this is the deck slab in cross section, there will be one stringer beam below this, another stringer beam. So these are the longitudinal girders. This is the deck slab. These are the stringers. So they are the stringes. Then the stringes will be below the stringes. We will have the cross girders. For want of space, actually, hope viewers can understand cross girders. So below this stringer beams, we will have cross girders. And the cross girders, will be connected to some nodes of the truss. Therefore, the load transfer will be only through the nodes. Therefore, here we will have a truss. On the left hand side. We will have a truss on the right hand side. This is the truss. One on either side of the bridge. So the load will be transferred from the deck slab. Deck slab to stringer beams. The load will be transferred to the longitudinal beams. Longitudinal beams will transfer the load to the cross girders, and the cross girders will be connected to the nodes of the truss. So through the nodes, the load will be transferred to the truss. So that is why always the truss will be given loads like this. You see, it will be, the load will be like this. That is, the load will be transferred through the bottom top card, or the load will be transferred through the bottom card, not in between the nodes. So it will be transferred only through the nodes, because you know, we can understand that this cross girder is connected to some nodes of the truss. So that is about the load transfer. Depending upon the position of the load, suppose the load is here, the load will be transferred to this cross girder and this cross girder, and the cross girder will transfer to the load to the nodes, of the truss. The cross girder will transfer the load to the nodes of the truss. The diagram is little congested. I think we can manage. So that is how the load gets transferred. Right. Now coming to the types of trusses we have, because without introduction, doing a problem is meaningless. But I will give you a very brief introduction. I will not take much time on this. Now there are three types of bridges. One is a through bridge. Next one is deck bridge. And half through bridge. Now, what is shown here is the deck bridge. That is, the deck slab and the bottom card of the truss, coincides. So, when we travel through the bridge, you will be able to see the web members on either side. The web members on either side will be seen. This is what is called a through bridge. The other type of bridge is called deck bridge. Deck bridge, here the deck slab will be this. This is the deck slab. The bridge will be below. You will not be able to see the truss. When we travel through the bridge, we will be able to see only the parapet wall or handrails on either side. So the bridge will be below the deck slab. So here the load transfer will be through the top card. Now here the load transfer will be, top card. Now here the load transfer is through the bottom card, because this is through which the load moves. The bottom cards will receive the loads. In the case of through bridge, the bottom cards will receive the loads. In the case of deck bridge, the top card will receive the loads. Because here you will be able to see the members of the truss when you travel through the bridge. Now here the truss is below, we will not be able to see. On the road you will be able to see only the handrails. The That is what is called deck bridge. First one is called through bridge. Then third one is called half through bridge. In the case of half through bridge, if this is the truss, the deck slab will be middle of the truss. That is, part of the truss will be above the deck slab, part of the truss will be below, because the truss height of the truss will be in the order of 6 meters, 7 meters, 8 meters, like that. Therefore, there it will be partly above the truss, partly above the deck slab, partly below. So, this is what is called a half through bridge. Half through bridge. Therefore, the load may be transferred through the bottom cord in the case of through bridges like this. The load may be transferred through the top cord in the case of deck bridges. In the case of half through bridge, arrangements will be made such that the load gets transferred through the bottom cord. The load will be transferred only through the bottom cord. So that is something about the load transfer. The load will be transferred from the wheel load to deck slab, deck slab to stringer beams, stringer beams to cross girders, cross girders to trusses on either side. The load transfer mechanism must be known. And we must know that when the truss is, because in this bridge the load may be here, the load may be here, or load may be here, depending upon the position of the load. Already we have learnt in the case of beams. So when the load position changes, so here the member force will also change, and some members, tension members, will become compression members, and compression members will become tension members. So how it gets changed, how to draw the influence line diagram, using the influence line diagram for the given system of loading, how to find out the maximum force in the member. Because in the case of trusses, there are varieties of truss: Pratt truss, Warren truss, K truss, like this. There are a number of trusses. So for what type of loading, for what type of bridge, which type of truss will be suitable, that will be a separate innovation. Because we cannot just like that adopt any truss for any span. That is a separate research. Which type of truss will be suitable for a particular bridge and for a particular type of loading. Of course, that we need not worry examination point of view, but as a civil engineer, this must be known. We must be aware of this. So what we do is only problems for the given data, how to draw the influence lines. But that is not sufficient. That is sufficient for examination purpose, but that is not sufficient for life. Therefore, with this very brief introduction, we will take up the numerical example. Now let us take a Pratt truss. This is a Pratt truss. This was invented by Professor Pratt. Professor Pratt has introduced the truss, therefore it is called a Pratt truss. Similarly, one Professor Warren has introduced one truss, so that is called a Warren truss. We have other trusses. We will take a few examples. We will start from the Pratt truss. So draw the influence lines. Draw the influence lines for the members P, Q, R, and S of the truss. So the truss may be 8 panels or 20 panels or 25 panels, we need not worry, because for getting the force in a particular member, we are going to make use of method of sections. So, in the case of method of section, we need not bother about the number of panels. So when it, when a 20 span truss is given, we need not fear. We need not fear. So we can just first of all, on seeing the figure, the viewers need not get confused, right? It is very simple only, right? Now, so I will explain the procedure as I have learnt my professor. My professor has given a very simple technique, so that I will discuss in the class. Actually, right. Now, if you are interested in getting the ILD for the force in the member P, influence line diagram for the force in the member P, ILD for P. You know, ILD gives you the variation of, as far as trusses are concerned, as we know, members will be either in tension or under compression, or same member partly under tension, partly under compression, right? When a unit load moves from L0 to L8, what happens to the force in the member P? How the force in the member P varies? That's all. When a unit load traverses from L0 to L8, what about the variation of the force in the member P? That is the first step, right? For getting that, what you do is, you pass a section, pass through cutting the member P, and cutting not more than 3 members. You pass a section XX, cutting the member P, that is under consideration, and cutting not more than 3 members. Now this cuts P, Q and R, not more than 3 members, right? Now this is the, now forget about the truss on the right hand side or on the left hand side. On the left hand side, you consider any one part of, that is what is called method of sections, but forget about the truss. Now, so this is the section, right? Now, before cutting, the member P will be carrying some force, Q will be carrying some force, R will be carrying some force. So let us represent the force in the P as a tension, it may be under compression also, let us assume tension. Now the member Q will be under a force, that also mark it as a Q, and the member R will also be under a force. So we have to, we should not just cut the truss and leave it like that. So they will be under some force, P, Q and R. Mark them, right? So that is the first one. So we have considered the, let us consider the part of the truss to the left of the section, forget about the right hand side. Now when we are interested in ILD for P, the other two cut members, they meet at the point L4. The other two members meet at the point L4. P is the member for which we want to draw the ILD. The other two cut members are Q and R, right? Certain things I am not writing, I think viewers can understand, right? So the other two cut members meet at the point L4. Therefore we have to apply unit load at L4. Similarly, moment center will also be L4. We have to take moment about V4, right? Now when we apply unit force here applying the unit force here, right, the reaction here will be, so when you find out the reaction, we have to imagine the whole truss. In the whole truss, when you apply unit force here, this is the middle of the truss. Therefore the reaction here will be 1/2. When you apply unit force, the reaction at the left end will be 1/2, the reaction at the right end will also be 1/2, because L4 represents the mid span of the truss, right? So this is the point where you apply the unit load. This is a reaction. Now, moment center is also L4. So take moment about that point. When we take moment about the point, we find there are three cut members. The other two members will not cause any moment. That is why you have chosen the point where the other two cut members meet. Therefore, when Q pass through the point L4 or pass through the point L4, they will not come into the picture. Therefore, when you take moment about the point L4, the reaction is 1 by 2 into 24, because the total span is 48 meters. So 1 by 2 into 24, right, in the cut section there are 3 members, so P into this distance equal to 5 meters, it is given, P into 5 meters, 1 by 2 into 24 plus P into 5 meters, and Q into 0, pass through the point, R into 0, pass through the point, so we need not, so this is the only unknown, is equal to 0, because it is a pin jointed truss, right, therefore the members will be under compression or tension only, right, so P into 5, therefore 5P equal to, this is 12 minus 12, so P equal to minus 12 by 5 equal to minus 2.4, therefore P will be under compression, 2.4 P will be under compression, therefore the ILE for P will be, see, for want of space I will just draw a small sketch. ILE will be where we have applied the unit load at the point L4. So at L4 is at the center, this is 2.4. So from one end to the other end, that is this is L0, this is our L8. So L0 to L8, the ILE will be of length 48 meters with ordinate equal to 2.4. Because it is compressive, it is minus. Actually, we should have drawn like this. Compression, we have to draw it like this. I have just drawn it reverse, right. So this is how we have to draw the influence line. So this is the influence line for a particular member. So what is the use of this, we will discuss after some time. We will just, this is how we have to draw the influence line for the entire length L0 to L8. This ordinate will have to be at the point where we have applied the unit load at the center. Because it is compression, draw it down like this. This is 2.4. This is ILD for P, because for want of space here, I have drawn it separately, right. So this is the influence line, right. Right. Now, ILD for the other two members will. Let us say ILD for the member R. ILD for the member R. Now, again, pass a section cutting the member R and cutting not more than 3 members. Therefore, the same section cuts the member R and also members P and Q. That is, the cut section should not cut more than 3 members. That is very important. Right. Now, therefore, this same diagram holds good. Only thing is, we have to apply the unit force at the point where the other two cut members meet. At the point, the other two cut members are P and Q, because now we are concentrating on R. So the other cut four or cut members are P and Q. P and Q meet at the point U3. So therefore, unit force is at U3. Moment center is also U3, where the other two cut members meet. Now, we will make use of the same diagram. We'll use this diagram, right? So this is P, this is Q, R. Now here, now we are applying the unit force here. Unit force at the point U3. When you apply unit force at the point U3, what is the reaction? The reaction will be, say, reaction at left RL. RL, we are taking moment about, we are going to find out the reaction. So when you find out the reaction, we have to imagine the total stress. So we are taking moment about L8, that's all. Moment about L8. Therefore, RL into 48 minus 1, this is the force applied, 1 minus 1 into 30. Because 6 meters, 6 meters, 6 meters. So this is at 18 meters from the left or 30 meters from the right. Therefore, minus 1 into 30, because we are taking moment about the point L8. So, RL into 48 minus 1 into 30 equal to 0. Therefore, RL will be 30 by 48. 30 by 48, the value will be 0.625. So the reaction here will be 0.625 for the position of the load, imagining the total stress RL equal to 0.625. Now also you have to take moment about the point U3. When you take moment about the point U3, it is RL into 18 meters, RL, that is 0.625 into 18 meters. We consider only the part on the left hand side of the cut section. We will not consider the total stress. That is the method of sections. Right. When we take moment about the point P, the point U3, R will cause a moment. R into the vertical distance. That will cause an anticlockwise moment. So minus R into 5 meters. R is a horizontal force and phi is a vertical distance. R into phi will be right. So that is the, and coming to P and Q, P pass through the point, R also pass through the point. They will not cause any moment. We eliminate both P and Q because they pass through the point, they pass through the moment center. They will not cause any moment. Therefore, that's all. Equal to 0. Equal to 0. Therefore, 5R minus 5R equal to minus 0.625 into 18. Therefore, R equal to the value of R 2.25 is the ordinate. Therefore, the influence line for R will be, it is tension, because it is with a plus sign, therefore tension. Tension. Therefore, starting from L0 to L8, now the ordinate will be at U3, where we have applied the unit load. So we applied the unit load in L3, therefore this is L3. So this is over L3. And this will be 18 meters, this will be 30 meters. So this ordinate will be equal to 2.25. It is to be drawn for the entire, that is, when the unit load is here, the load into this ordinate will be the force in the member. When the unit load is here, or a single concentrated load of 40 kN. So 40 into this ordinate will be the force in the member. When the given force is here, the force into the ordinate here will be the force in the member. When the given load is exactly over the point U3, so the load into this ordinate will be the maximum force to which the member R will be subjected to. Because we must know where we are going to apply this. Somewhere you must be aware. So that is a triangle running from L0 to L8 with the maximum ordinate of L3. L3 ordinate is plus, therefore tension. The member R will be under tension. It is a bottom chord member of a simply supported truss. The member P is a top chord member which is under compression, which already we have got the value under compression. Right. So that is about the influence line diagram for the member R. Then next is ILD for Q. ILD for Q. Now Q is an inclined member. Again the same section holds because this cuts the member Q also. Now we are considering Q. It passes section cutting the member Q and cutting not more than 3 members. Therefore it again cuts P, Q and R. Now our concentration now is in Q. ILD for Q. But the thing is, the other two cut members are parallel members. The P is a horizontal member, R is also a horizontal member, they will not meet. Therefore, where to apply the unit force? Where to take moment? So that problem is there. And here, Q is an inclined member. Therefore, what we do is, we apply the force at the left end of the member and right end of the member. Once at the left end, let us say unit load at the U3, unit load at the left end of the member. Because the other two forces we cannot eliminate. P and R are parallel members. Wherever you take moment, either P or R will come into the picture along with the Q. Along with the Q, P or R will come into the picture. Therefore, what we do here is, we are going to make use of sigma V equal to 0. So, apply the force at L3, unit load at L3. We know, when the unit load is applied at U3 at the left end of the member, the reaction will be 0.625. Already we have got it. Therefore, certain values you can repeatedly use. For everything you need not draw the diagram. So you can, that is why I have not rubbed off, I am just making use of the diagram. Right. Therefore, RL equal to, now here we are not fixed any moment center. What we do is, we just take sigma V equal to 0. Use the condition sigma V equal to 0. Equal to 0 gives 0.625 is upwards. 0.625 is the reaction. 0.625 is upwards. Minus Q into cos of this angle. This angle is actually um, cos theta is 50 degree 12 minutes. So this value theta equal to 50 degree 12 minutes, because this is 6 meters, this is 5 meters, so this is 10 theta is 6 by 5 is 10 theta, so from which you can find out the value of theta, and for resolving we will require cos theta, so cos theta will be equal to 0.64. For getting the value, you have to make use of tan theta. Tan theta is opposite side by adjacent side. Tan theta. That is equal to 50 degrees, 12 minutes. So, cos theta is required for resolving the force in the vertical direction. Right. That calculation is separate. Right. Now, sigma v equal to 0 gives 0.625 minus q into cos, say cos 50 degree 12 minutes. 50 degree 12 minutes. This is equal to 0. This is downwards. When this is resolved in the vertical direction, that will be downwards. P will not cause any vertical component. R will not cause. We have to consider the forces P and R also. But here, when we resolve in the vertical direction, P and R, they are horizontal members, they will not give any vertical component. Cos 90 equal to 0. Therefore, when we consider the equilibrium of the part of the truss on the left hand side, consider all the forces, use sigma v equal to 0. So, therefore, the reaction is 0.625. These two will not cause any vertical component. So, this will cause q into cos 45 equal to 0 plus one more point is within the cut section we have the unit load also. Therefore, that also has to be considered. So, minus 1. Whatever is there within the cut section, that also we have to consider equal to 0. All forces to the left of the cut section we have to consider. So, minus 1 equal to 0. So, that will give q equal to 0.375. q equal to 0.375. Minus 0.558, sorry. Actually, the sum of these two is 0.375. That is, 1 minus 0.625 is 0.375. On solution, q equal to minus 0.586. Therefore, q is 0.586 compression. 0.586 compression. Therefore, when the load is at the point U3, again for want of space I am drawing a small diagram. Actually it is 0, it is 48. L0 to L8. For the entire length you have to draw. Now we have applied the unit force at the point U3. Therefore, at U3 is at 18 meters. The remaining is 30 meters. Total is 48. So, here it is compression. So, mark it down. Compression 0.586. So, this value is 0.586. Now, we have to study whether the member will be under compression, because we have applied the force only at one end of the member, we have to apply the force at the other end of the member also. Right. In the earlier cases, we applied the force at a point where the other two cut members meet. Now here it is different. We are not taking moment about a moment center. Therefore, here we are applying unit force at the left and the right end of the member. Now, just now we have completed the application of unit load at the left end of the member. Now, so this is the member. We have applied the unit force here. This we have completed. Now, we will consider the unit force at the right end of the member. So, unit load at the right end is L4. For the member Q, left end is U3, right end is L4. Now, when we apply unit force at the point, unit load at the point L4, for which also we have the reaction. L4 is the mid span. So, the reaction here is 0.5. I think now you can understand why I am retaining the two figures. So, 0.5. These values already we have got it. Right, 0.5. Now, you apply the condition sigma v equal to 0 gives 0.5 is the reaction in the upward direction. There is no other force. Unit force is beyond the cut section. We can forget about this. You have to consider all forces within the cut section. Now, P is a horizontal member, will not cause any vertical component. R is a horizontal member, will not cause any moment. So, Q into cos 45. Therefore, minus Q into cos 45, of cos 52 degrees or 50 degrees or 12 minutes. 52. That's all. Equal to 0. This is. Now, we are not considered the unit force because unit force is beyond the cut section. Previously, we have considered because unit force was within the cut section. We have to consider all forces to the left of the cut section, not beyond the cut section. All right. Therefore, Q into cos 45 is equal. Therefore, Q will be on solution. This will become minus when it goes to the right hand side. On simplification, we will find Q equal to 0.781. You are getting with the positive sign. Therefore, this is tension. Therefore, when the unit load is to the left of the cut section, the member acts as a compression member. When the unit load is to the right of the cut section, the same member acts as a tension member. Therefore, here at L4 at this point, here it is tension. This value is tension 0.781. Therefore, it changes from tension member, compression member to tension member. So, this is the ILD for Q. Therefore, when the load is to the left of this point, the member will act as a compression member. When the load is to the right of the section, the member will, the same member will act as a compression member up to certain position of the load and tension member beyond certain position of load. Suppose, after drawing the influence line diagram, it is given a 100 kilonewton force is moving from left to right. Right. What is the maximum compressive force to which the member Q will be subjected to? What is the maximum tensile force to which the member is subjected to? If it is asked, it is a moving load. So, 100 kilonewton load will have to be placed here. 100 into 0.586 will be the maximum compressive force to which the member will be subjected to for the given system of loading. Again, we know there are 5 different systems of loading. We have taken one simple example of a concentrated load. So, 100 into 0.586. Right. What is the maximum tensile force to which the member is subjected to? again load is 100 only. Now the for maximum tensile force, the concentrated load will have to occupy the section where the ordinate is maximum. So 100 into 0.781, therefore 78.1 kilonewton is the maximum tensile force to which the member Q will be subjected to. Member Q will be subjected to. So that is how. So whether it is UDL shorter than the span, UDL longer than the span, that we have to just apply like this only. So next is ILD for the member S. ILD for S. Again, for X, we have to pass a section cutting the member S and not more than 3 members. Right. For getting ILD for the member S, you cut member S and cutting not more than 3 members. Therefore, we will pass a section cutting the member S and cutting member U2, U3 and L3, L4. So that is the section. Again, the other two cut members, namely U2, U3 and L3, L4, they are parallel members. So they will meet. They will not meet. Therefore, whether you choose a point on the top chord or bottom chord as a moment center, either the bottom chord member or top chord member will come into the picture in addition to S. If you choose this point, the top chord member will come into the picture. If you choose some point here, the bottom member will come into the picture. Therefore, you cannot eliminate the two members. Any one member will come into the picture. Therefore, here again, what we are going to do is, we are going to make use of sigma V equal to 0. So, here also, we are going to apply the force to the left of the cut section and to the right of the cut section. Because always, influence line is always due to a moving unit load. So, we will apply the unit load to the left of the cut section and to the right of the cut section. So this is the cut section, right? To the left of the cut section we have L3, to the right of the cut section we have L4. So applying unit load at L3 is just again U3, above U3. So this is same, the line of action is same. So, we will be applying the unit force at L3 here. Now also, the reaction will be 0.625. When you take moment about the right support, RL into 48 minus 1 into 30 equal to 0, will be equal to 0.625. Right. Now, we are having only this part of the truss, namely, this is our cut section. This is the force in this member. This is the force in this member. And this is the cut member. This is, let us call as P1. This is R. This is S. That is a cut section. That is, in this cut section, we call this as, say, P1. This is S. This is already we have chosen to be R. So, this is one cut member, this is another cut member, this is the third cut member, not more than 3 members. Now, we are going to make use of sigma V equal to 0. Sigma V equal to 0, again, we find reaction is 0.625. Reaction is 0.625. And to the left of the cut section, we have unit force. Unit force is applied at L3. So that is also within the cut section. Therefore, minus 1. Then plus S, because this is in the upward direction, reaction is in the upward direction, S is in the upward direction, unit force is in the downward direction. These two are horizontal members, they will not cause any vertical force. Cos 90 equal to 0. Therefore, we have considered all the forces, the sum equal to 0. Therefore, SE equal to 1 minus 0.625 equal to 0.375. So, SE equal to 0.375 tension. We are getting with the plus sign. We have assumed this to be tensile. We are getting with the positive sign. Therefore, what you assumed is correct. So, it is tension. Now, again, we have to draw from L0 to L8. We have applied the unit force at L3. L3 is at 18 meters. So, this is L3 is at 18 meters. This is 30 meters. Right. So, it is tension. Therefore, mark it above. So, this value equal to 0.375. Right. Now, we have one more part. We will stop here and we have one more part. One more part is ILD, mean the unit load at the right end of the member. Right. I mean to the right of the cut section. Right of the cut section. Now, we applied for this cut section, we applied to the left of the cut section, we have completed. To the right of the cut section, it is at L4. So, unit load will be at L4, right of the cut section. When unit load is at L4, namely here, beyond the cut section, actually now the cut section is different. Cut section will be, this is a vertical member. Right. So, this is P1, this is our vertical member, S, already this member is R. So, this is our cut section, P1, S and R. Now, unit load is applied at L4. When unit load is applied at L4, we know the reaction here is 1 by 2 because L4 is the midspan. Therefore, it is 0.5. The reaction is 0.5. So, we are going to make use of sigma V equal to 0. Sigma V equal to 0 gives a reaction is 0.5. It is in the upward direction. Plus, S is also in the upward direction. We have assumed all forces to be tensile like this. Tensile. P will not cause any vertical component. P1 is a horizontal member. When it resolves in the vertical direction, that will not give any component. R will not give any vertical. Again, it is a horizontal force. That will not give any component. Unit force is beyond the cut section. So, that also need not be considered. Therefore, equal to 0. Therefore, SE equal to minus 0.5. SE equal to minus 0.5. Or SE equal to 0.5 compression. Therefore, when it is at the center, it is under compression. This value equal to 0.5. So, connect these two and this. We have to draw up to L0 to L8. So, here this is 24 meters. So, here it is 18 meters. So, this value is 824. So, between 18 and 24, it changes the sign. This is ILD for S. So, this is due to the unit load moving from left to right, the variation of the force in the member. This is giving you up to this point, wherever the unit force is there, the member will be under tension. Beyond this point, when the unit load moves, the member will be under compression. Suppose they are given a UDL of some value. Then if it is shorter than the span, you know, if you know the cut section, average loading on the left equal to the average loading on the right, that you have to use whatever you applied for beams. There we have used for finding out the bending moment and the shear force. Now we are using for finding out the axial force in the member. Procedure is same. Average loading on the left of the, to the left of the section, average loading to the right of the section. You have to arrange the loading, then intensity of UDL multiplied by the area of ILD below the UDL will give the force. Same thing. So this is always, ILD is always due to your moving unit load. So for want of space, I have just drawn the diagram. I'll just show only one example, one case. Because without knowing this, some students used to draw a small triangle. Actually, it has to be drawn for the entire span. When you apply the force at the L3, here it is under a tension, here it is under tension, and when you apply at L4, it is under compression. So this is how you have to draw the influence line diagram. So this is due to these values, you know, these values we know. We have to mark the, so this is ILD for, yes, so like that only we have to draw the ILD over the entire span. For want of space, I have just drawn small diagrams like this. All the diagrams will have to be drawn like this. So I have told you for UDL, suppose if the truss is subjected to a moving concentrated load of 200 kilonewton, if you are asked to find out what is the maximum tensile force to which the member is subjected to. Tensile force means you apply the load here where the ordinate is maximum 200. 200 into this ordinate. This ordinate is 0.375. So the maximum tensile force to which member S will be subjected to is 200 into 0.375. When the moving load is a concentrated load. Right. What is the maximum compressive force to which the member S will be subjected to? When a load of 200 kilonewton traverses from left to right of the truss. Then you have to place the load at the ordinate where the ordinate is maximum 200 compressive. So 200 into 0.5 equal to 100 kilonewton. 100 kilonewton is the maximum compressive force to which the member S will be subjected to. Like that you have to draw the influence line diagram and apply, use the influence line diagram for getting the force in the member, tensile force in the member or compressive force in the member due to the given system of loading. So we have discussed only one example. Maybe on discussion of one or two more examples, whatever is not clear here will be clear. So that completes one lecture on influence line diagram for pin jointed trusses. We will continue further problems in the future lectures, right? So thank you for your patience.